My name is Gary Vasslash. I'm the editor of Automotive Design and Production magazine, and I want to thank you all for being here. I hope you enjoyed the lunch. You know, just one thing that it occurred to me while I was listening to the presentations this morning, which I found to be rather fascinating, hope you did too, is just so you sort of get it, that the way we tried to lay this thing out was the after Dr. Leonard made his presentation, which I thought was rather fascinating, that the plan was we would first give an overview of what's going on in the autonomy and mobility space. Then we would look at the design, because basically once you have the landscape laid out, you have to somehow put things on it, which explains why we had a variety of designers and city planners and so on, because you know that is going to be essential to driving this forward. And then this session, okay? And so the intent of this session is, let's put some meat on those bones. Let's talk about the engineering. Let's talk about the ways and means that we're going to be able to get this stuff on the road. Then following me, Bill Hampton's presentation session will be about how do you pay for the whole thing, okay? So it was basically overview, design, engineer, then perhaps manage the whole thing. And then at the end, at 4 p.m., for all of the speakers that are left, we're going to bring all of them back on stage. And what we want to do is try to get some more engagement, because, I mean, you guys are sitting here and listening politely. There's probably some things you want to know at the end of the day, and we'll take that opportunity to do so. Now, you all have these things, okay? And inside these things are the biographies of the people, so I'm not going to give their biographies, because you probably want to hear what they have to say rather than listening to the biography that you can read just as easily as I can. So the first speaker leading off the session is Swamy Kotagiri, which I just destroyed his name, but my name's Vasslash and I destroy it all the time. And he's the chief technology officer at Magna. If you're not familiar with Magna, it's basically does approximately everything in the auto industry, near as I can tell. I mean, maybe tires you guys don't do, but that's about it. So it's a very comprehensive company doing a lot of things, and I've known Swamy for some time, and I know you're gonna enjoy this. So Swamy, screwed up your name, but please come up anyway.
Thanks, Gary. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and Gary, you did not screw up my name. I've heard worse. So thanks for the invitation. What I want to try to talk about today is a perspective from a Magna's vantage point as we touch the broad portfolio of how we see some of the key trends. What does it mean? How do we transform the transportation into the future? So with that said, one of the key things that we always use, and some of the slides here I thought would be interesting based on the topic and the relevance, is engineering. What does it mean? I try to talk to a lot of students at various levels, all the way from middle school to universities and grad students and PhDs, and try to tell them what the automotive industry is about. And I think it's amazing to listen to their perspective sometimes of what they think it is. It's not anymore what we used to be talking about 10, 15 years ago. It's really a complex confluence of electromechanical software, hardware, telematics, connectivity, cybersecurity, and so on and so forth. So it's just a great amalgamation of many things, and here's my viewpoint of what we see happening in the next 5, 10, 15 years. The importance is not as much exactly of the number of years, but the tendency of where we are going, right? So with that as the beginning, how do I forward this? Just this, or? Yeah, okay, got it. A little bit of Magna, $36 billion global company, about 309 manufacturing locations, which keeps changing every week, about 150,000 employees, and a dominant position in North America, as well as global from different product perspectives. I'm not going to talk as much about each of the products. I think Gary summarized it very well. We do a lot of things in the automotive, and the important point here is not to talk about each of the products, but the holistic view that it gives us to be able to talk at a system level of what it means rather than each component. Okay, pushing the green button. Somebody said it's easy to get AI, but it's very difficult to get AV, audiovisual. So our competitive position here, as we talk about, there is different levels of changes that are happening. Some are transitional changes in driving the autonomy, highly automated driving to fully automated driving, which in effect drives increasing vehicle connectivity, talks about electrification and hybridization. And as the industry is changing, we try to address the mobility of the future, the last mile, first mile, the sharing economy, and so on and so forth. So we are not only just addressing the systems and components, but the overall model from a tier one perspective. I promise I'm pushing this button. So these are some of the things that we talked about that we see in the next 5 years. There is going to be a transitional change in the autonomy. So you'll see a lot of features that will make driving comfortable, convenient, and safer, which, as we talk, I'll touch upon what it really means 10, 15 years from now. As we talk about this, one of the key things is increasing the vehicle connectivity, either V2V or V2X, you know, overall. And one of the other important topic that comes as a result of that is the cybersecurity, as the data comes in and out of the car. Electrification and hybridization to address the more regulatory and legislative, whether it's CO2 emissions, whether it is zero fatalities, or addressing the miles per gallon. And I talked a little bit on the new mobility concepts and the new industry players that are emerging because of the data. As we look at this, what does the overall macroeconomic social changes are happening in the next 10, 15 years? So if you look at it from a perspective of 2030 and beyond, which is, I call it long term, you know, 2.5 cycles of the automotive industry, I want to bring out some of the key points that don't at the surface seem very obvious, but are related to our industry. By 2030, the average person will have about 4 to 5 packages a week delivered by drones. Why am I saying that and why is it important? It's not as much the fact that you're going to get your Amazon packages dropped off at your house. It's more the technology behind it in terms of global positioning and accuracy within plus or minus a few centimeters and what it means to autonomous driving. Maybe somebody can help me change this. One of the key things we talk about is artificial intelligence. It's a very broad topic, but if you look at it, some of the key aspects that you touch on are machine intelligence and some of the environmental models that we are creating, which will enable level 4, level 5 autonomous driving, is how do we get the data that is curated and labeled to an environmental model outside that'll help us decide in a little bit more constrained environment to make a decision. So if you're in a car that's supposed to be driving autonomously and you face a situation, there's an 80-year-old person, there is a tree, and there is 30 kids, what decision do I make and how? A lot of that will be based on a lot of environmental models and therefore drives the compute and the Bayesian algorithm and so on and so forth. So it's important that we understand that aspect. So although it really doesn't look like it's directly involved to the automotive industry. 3D printing, it's been talked about quite a bit. One of the key things, interesting things that you see is just not the technology for additive manufacturing, but also the processing of the materials that are required to be able to do it in an economical and sustainable way. Today, you use a lot of this technology in tooling. So you need really specific material properties and specific functionality that is required, but don't have to be doing mass production. So that's where it is used, but here is an interesting fact. By 2030, you can actually have the food taste the way you want, but also smell the way you want. It's a great combination. That's where they're saying 3D printing is going. I use it more for metals and so on and so forth, but it's good to keep up. Gary, you got to give me 2 more minutes just because of not being able to progress this. As we talk about 2030, there is 2 billion more people on planet Earth. why are we concerned from an automotive perspective? It actually drives city planning. If you look at cities in North America versus cities in China and Europe, in some cases it's a grid system. In some cases it's a star or a circular system going out. That's going to define the last mile, first mile transportation. It's going to define the future business models of car sharing and ride hailing and so on and so forth. So it becomes interesting to see whether you need to have a zero emission capable vehicle that will drive within city centers and then go out and be driven by normal propulsion. A lot of these things are going to be driven by this macroeconomic trend here. So we talk a lot of autonomous drive or fully automated driving. What does it really mean as we look forward? Again, the important part is not the specific number of self-driving cars, is that there is going to be a lot of self-driving cars. And what does it mean to our industry? From a tier one perspective, I'll give some examples of what does it mean and how do we take all the data that I just talked about and make it very tangible and specific to our product portfolio. So if you look at it, in broadly, we just take everything and break it down to three major pillars in terms of autonomy, electrification, and new economy, which is we call the foundational pillars to drive the mobility of the future. From an autonomy perspective, the timing and the challenges are important, and what the ADAS is a very broad term that's being used very generally. But timing, as I said, I think we see an evolutionary change happening. The proliferation is going to be at a much higher rate if you're talking, as I said at the beginning, is a lot of these features that you have that will enhance your driving experience but still require you to be in position to take control. If that's the definition, there is going to be a very rapid and wide proliferation in the industry. If you're truly looking at a point where you don't have to take control of the vehicle, we do believe that it's further away than what's being talked about. And not even considering the ethical, moral, and other legal issues that need to be addressed. And ADAS, I just touched upon features. They will be proliferating everywhere as you see it. A simple roadmap of how we look at it. Again, right, the importance is just the steps that we see. It's the partially automated permanent driver supervision required. This is, if you go to different places, you see different definitions in terms of what levels they're called. But this is a simple explanation of what it really means. Thank you. Okay. Yes, it does. Thank you. So it's the fully automated vehicles we see as a time beyond the 2025. Again, the important part being no driver supervision required at all. As I touched upon, as this comes out, the most important part is the huge amounts of data that comes into and outside the vehicle, whether it be driving critical information that will affect and influence your braking and some of the safety critical functions of the car. And some of it is just convenience. You're driving and you have your profile in and they know you like a certain type of food or you need a Starbucks and it kind of gives you indications. It's using your presence in the vehicle. Now, if I have all of that, how do I segregate it? How do I put it in different places and keep it secure is an interesting challenge. Electrification, pure EV versus hybridization in general, our thought process as we look at it is even by 2025, pure electric vehicles are still in single digits as a percentage of the total volume produced. If you're talking of hybrids in some way, shape, or form, whether it's micro, mild, PHEVs included, it'll be a substantial portion. More than 55% of the total volume will have some form of hybridization. So that kind of drives our focus and efforts in looking at subsystems. Evolving functionality. This is a common question that is asked in many places. As I talked about the broad portfolio of Magna, We have mirrors, but if you look at a mirror today and look at the content in it, you have antennas, you have chips, you have augmented display systems. So there is a lot of content in it, which is not just a mirror anymore. The mechanical latches are not latches anymore. We introduced the first EV, or call it the e-latch, in many many of the platforms. So there's a lot of content augmentation, taking away the mechanical aspect, but providing features in software. So a lot of that continues to accelerate as we go forward. We talk of powertrain. We had a lot of ancillary systems, like mechanical pumps that used to run all the time. You don't need to. You provide power on demand. Therefore, you are reducing your parasitic losses, therefore help the efficiency, and therefore reduce the CO2. And it's a perpetual cycle that continues to improve. New economy in terms of big cities, you know, but the travel you're talking about is 5,000 miles or less, and it's a huge opportunity. Again, going back to the Magna portfolio, we are not looking at it from a system perspective. We are looking at holistically, whether it's lightweighting from our body chassis system, exterior group, whether it's, you know, mirrors, whether it is seating, whether it's, you know, electronics across, providing electronics specific to ADAS. If you look at the whole picture, if there is somebody who's talking about the car of the future and how we should do it, most probably we would have touched base with them, or they have approached us. In our MagnaStar facility in Graz, not only do we engineer full vehicles, but we also make them. A good example is the Mercedes G-Wagon that we've been making for the last 34 years, and many other models, working with our OEM partners. So that's an opportunity for us. I talked about, as I said, one of the key things is looking at some of the mega trends in terms of cities, the new residents, the population changes, and how it affects the transportation of the future, which leads to the sharing economy that I briefly touched on, and how are we preparing to deal with that part of it. It kind of gives you a synopsis of how we are looking at the big trends, what it means to our portfolio, and I'll touch upon some of the key technologies that we are working on or just about to launch that touches on the topics. I talked about mirrors. Mirrors used to be just mirrors, an aid for your eye, but if you look at it, it's augmented in many different ways. Sometimes it's augmented with a display, it's getting smaller, and at some point of time will ultimately replaced by cameras. So we have a lot of technologies that are either coming into play or will be in the near future. We are the largest camera ADAS system provider. We are working on a next generation radar that actually helps not only just identifying that there is an object there, but can actually start giving an image of what that object looks like. So that's the next generation radar. In terms of improving thermal efficiency, here's an example of an active aero grill that directs air, not only improving the ride quality, but also improving the thermal efficiency in the vehicle. We do believe that it is a very cohesive ecosystem in the future, that we cannot be doing everything by ourselves, so we look outside the four walls and see what the other industries are doing in terms of technology. And as a part of our open innovation, we work with startups, we work with, you know, other companies. Here's an example of a company, participation of Magna in a company called Peloton, which is working on platooning of large trucks. As I mentioned in the beginning of my presentation, we have 300 plus manufacturing locations. One of the key things for us is to work on machine learning and advanced robotics. We spend a lot of time on it, working with various universities and research projects, actually implementing cells and lines. Here is an example of how we look at our assembly lines and, you know, a lot of dexterity, human-like dexterity in robot arms was taken from an example of robots that did, you know, surgical exercises in the past. And our question was, how can we apply it to tooling and fixturing and so on? So that's one of the initiative that we have, which we call the smart factory or the factory of the future, and we continue to work with it. And as we see, one of the key things is as advanced robotics progresses, we can actually bring back manufacturing irrespective of the labor cost, because that becomes the nullifier at that point. So that's kind of some of the concepts that we're looking at, some examples of how we are looking at and how we want to participate going into the future. And one of the key thoughts for us is we cannot really guess the future, but we can actually help frame it and make it. And that's our motto. One of the key drivers for Magna is how do we drive excellence and inspire innovation? Hopefully it helps spark a debate. Thank you.
I thought one of the things that struck me as being very interesting was the 2030 when we'll be 3D printing our food. It struck me that you think about Star Trek and how the iPhone was apparently inspired in some ways by what they were doing. And I was thinking about Captain Picard when he would say tea, Earl Grey, hot, and which is sort of a discussion of the interface that we have with vehicles as they become more automated. So our next speaker is Glen DeVos. He's the Vice President of Engineering and Services for Delphi Electronics and Safety. And for those of you in the Detroit area, you think, Delphi, that big building out there in Troy. Well, I was surprised to discover that Glen is actually in Mountain View, California, which I guess just sort of indicates the shift that's going on in this industry. So Glen.
Sure. Thank you very much. So good afternoon. As Gary mentioned, I'm based in Mountain View, and it is really part of the shift in our industry and responding to that. This is the one. Excellent. So what I'll talk about a little bit, I'll focus in on what does it mean for us as a tier one and as a technology provider when you think about these trends. How do we have to respond? How do we respond in terms of the technologies we innovate, but also how we do our work and some of the challenges and that brings. Within Delphi, we've been talking about safe, green, and connected for, it seems like, forever. And these trends are probably more appropriate now than ever. In fact, if anything, they're just accelerating. Safe from the ever-increasing adoption of active safety systems and the greater penetration rates and deployment of those technologies, especially in light of the upturn in fatalities per year here in the U.S. Green, with all of the 2025 emissions requirements and fuel economy requirements that are definitely a challenge for all of us. And then connectivity, probably the biggest change in terms of what's happening with connecting the car is the car becomes really part of the Internet of Things. It's really a software platform now. So how do we deal with that, especially as a traditional tier one and a kind of a hardware-oriented company? So for us, if you think about this, well, what does it mean as we're doing our work on the vehicle? The first is computing power. The computing power is now, and the demands for computing power now are exceeding Moore's law. So we're more than doubling the computational needs on the vehicle every 2 years. It's remarkable what that's driving, and it really forces a much greater amount of software, a much greater amount of validation and complexity onto the vehicle. As I mentioned, the expansion of the IoT, as the vehicle becomes connected to it and more of the content in the vehicle is either dependent or provided outside of the vehicle, that means we have to manage all of that brought in or that streamed in content and what that brings. And then finally, that convergence. So you're seeing more of these things coming together. The domains in the vehicle are not just independent, they're really converging in many cases. And so that brings a lot of complexity for us. It brings, for the technology developers, you can't think of these things in isolation anymore. As we look at a car then, what does that mean? You have a typical car now has over 50 different computers of varying size and complexity, but clearly all 50 different ECUs or electronic control units that require a significant amount of development effort. You have over 100 million lines of code now in a typical premium vehicle and climbing. In fact, that number just continues to grow at a much faster rate than any other part of the content of the vehicle. And when you compare it to other systems that we tend to think of as really sophisticated, the car stands out well above those products or those planes or those apps in terms of the content and complexity. We kind of tend to break it down into little constituent elements, which you can think of simplistically, but when you put it all together in the vehicle, it is by far and away the most complex software-driven item out on the roads. So for us, as we look at it, you need a couple things, and you really need to focus on these if you're going to provide these technologies or services. One is flexible system designs. You cannot design systems for each vehicle independently as a one-off. You have to be thinking about platforming strategies that go across multiple vehicle platforms as well as customers. Best value innovations, you always have to be thinking about where is the value add? How do we innovate in a way that brings simplicity to the end product and countermands all of this added complexity? Vehicle integration experience, getting all of this to work together and getting it to work flawlessly over all of the use cases is incredibly complex. How do you test that? How do you validate that? And how do you support that over the life of that vehicle? And then agile software solutions. And this is probably one of the biggest challenges we face as an automotive company is the shift from hardware to software. It's not just software, but software becomes an increasing part of what we do. On an average program that we develop for an ECU, software constitutes probably over 60, 70% of the engineering effort going into that product now. It used to be 10, 20, you know, 15 years ago. It's now almost, it's by far and away the majority of what we do is software development, integration, and test compared to the hardware piece. I can tell you 99% of my issues are software related. Very few are hardware related. And so as a tier one, that means we have to bring in-house management teams, thinking, and capability that is in the software domain. And for many of us, that's not our background. This is one of the biggest challenges, and it means you have to develop that capability inside, but you also have to partner really intelligently. It really puts a focus on how do you pick your partners. So as you think about how these things, safe, green, and connected, come together, what are some of the great opportunities? Well, one is automated driving. It really is, when you think about, it's really rare you have the coming together of tremendous societal benefit, whether it's urban congestion or traffic fatalities. The technology is absolutely amazing. And the commercial benefits. When you have all of those threes coming together, like automated driving brings, it's a game changer for the industry. You also have, again, going back to emissions, the 48 hybrid electrical systems. How do we get to the right level of fuel economy and emissions performance? And then finally, the connected car. I think that, I can tell you, anybody that thinks they understand what that means today is probably wrong, because I don't think anybody understood what the phone would be doing 10 years ago. But the car is going through that kind of a transformation right now. So one of the things, again, coming back to, so what are we doing about it? One of the things you don't hear a lot about, we tend to focus on the technology and the functionality side of it, is the electrical architecture that supports it. What are we doing inside the car to manage all the data, to manage all the power and signal distribution so that it's reliable and can operate flawlessly, and that data gets managed on the vehicle? So electrical architecture is one of the key enablers for us, and it's one of the areas that we're constantly looking for people and talent that really understand that. It's a systems architecture now. One of the other aspects is active safety. We have we talk about automation, we talk about active safety as the building blocks for automation. One of the really interesting things about automation or automated driving is that it's not a standalone technology. That what we develop for automated driving directly applies to ADAS. So we take those technologies, we bring them in to our current ADAS portfolio, which means there's already a business and a commercialization path for those technologies. So it's not maybe I invest now in 10 years, I get a return. I get the return today because I sell that in my current programs. And what this chart shows is that 80% of the safety benefit actually is achieved by getting to level 2, by giving you that extra second of warning or the advance so you can avoid the accidents. I mentioned all of this tends to then come together as the building blocks for automated driving. Automated driving is one of our key areas of focus, but you need to have all of these pieces. You need to understand that vehicle architecture. You have to have the active safety building blocks because that's the whole perception and controls piece of it. You need the connectivity, not just for infotainment, but for managing all of the other support functions, and finally software. I can't say that enough. It's about capacity, capability, and really developing that. That is what will determine if you can really compete in this space or if you get displaced by one of the new entrants. So as we think about connectivity, this is an area that's really changing fast. You have, between cellular, Wi-Fi, and what we call V to everything. In terms of connecting the car, not just to the infrastructure, but to people, to other cars, and to other events. And so we see this as an essential part of not just automated driving, but an enhancement to ADAS, and really another layer of protection around the occupants in the vehicle. So that's why we're very excited about what we think can be accomplished with vehicle-to-vehicle and DSRC. But you can also apply it, like we just saw in the last presentation, into other fuel economy and fuel savings applications here in the commercial vehicles, where they can see significant increases in fuel economy, 6 to 8%, by just driving closer. And those technologies exist between radar, cameras, and V2V. All of those technologies are there. And then for us, how do you put it together, and it's great to see it on a PowerPoint, but how do you know it works? So that's why for us, doing pilot programs are so important. So we've just started an automated mobility on demand pilot program in Singapore, where we're going to stand up a fleet over the next 3 years of AMOD vehicles, and then on the first part, learn how they operate, what is required, to make that work, both in the vehicle as well as in the connected ecosystem, but then also, how does the user interact with that? It's one thing to say we're going to have automated vehicles that are going to take people around, but if the user experience is not a good one, people will not use the technology. They'll shy away from it. So we have to also make sure that from a user experience standpoint, it really is, and it's a great experience. People want to use this method of getting around. And that's why these pilots are so important, because it gives you real-world experience. You can try it. You can see how people react. You can adjust and correct. And that's one of the things, if you think about Silicon Valley, it's all about getting out and failing fast. Get the experience. In the automotive space, we tended to think of, the traditional V diagram, right? The system's V, where you spend a lot of years developing and validating before you let anybody see it. Well, that's not necessarily the fastest way to get to the best solution. Now, you have to be responsible in how you do this, of course. But this allows us to get that real-world feedback, so when the technology really gets introduced, the consumer experience is a good one. It really is a compelling one. And then you think about all of us and what we expect from our cars. Again, it's a whole new area of market opportunities, whether it's OTA, bring your own device, or the brought in media, it's security, it's big data, or it's OTA. And we see OTA as a key enabler for the software-defined vehicle. You have to have OTA. It cannot be a static platform. You have to maintain and update it over its expected life. And big data is probably one of the areas, I would say, that's the least exploited today, probably the least understood. But as we talk about machine learning and AI and data predictive analytics and those types of things, we know there are tremendous opportunities out there for us. But you need, as a tech provider in this space, you need two things. One, you need domain knowledge, because it isn't good enough to simply aggregate and parse and host data. You have to create value with it. And that means domain knowledge. And that's the advantage people in our space have. We understand how cars work. And we understand what it means when we get data off cars. And we can we can create value from that. Simply hosting data doesn't do you any good. You have to create value with it. So we see great opportunities for big data. And then finally, I mentioned OTA. As the software continues to come into the vehicle and more features are software defined or software enabled, you have to have OTA. It's just absolutely required. For automated driving, it's a given. So you have to be able to manage that, which means you have to have a secure environment within which to operate. And again, creating some really interesting challenges, but great opportunities for us who are participating in this. As I mentioned, when you think about the complexity of these systems, it's hard to, in some days, it's hard to get your head around just how complex it is. And how do you bring it all to market? And how do you get there as fast as possible? And the answer is through really good partnerships. As a technology provider, if you think you can do it all, that's a recipe for failure, going slow, and coming up with a suboptimal solution. You simply can't. You have to have the right partners that can bring the technologies, and you have to have flexible working relationships. And again, that's a challenge for those of us in the traditional automotive hardware space, where we tend to think of things in a hierarchical fashion with well-defined supplier agreements and annual price downs. That is not how this environment works. Your partner one day may be your competitor the next. Your supplier may actually be your customer. You have to be agile in terms of how you approach this. For those of us who have been in the automotive space a long time, it really is a change in the operating model, because it doesn't fit the traditional roles we tend to operate with. But it is absolutely required to get to where we have to be to develop and launch these platforms. And I think that's it. Well, thank you very much for your time. I appreciate it very much.
You know, one of the things that Glen said that I think is quite interesting is that if we go back not that many years ago, that a company like Delphi, you'd say, you know, what are you? And they'd say, well, we're an automotive supplier. And, you know, now it's quite clearly they're a technology provider. I mean, we heard the same thing from Magna. And so, you know, we see this shift in even the way the companies are perceiving themselves and how they're getting capacity to do things. Now, another thing we've heard is that the customer, meaning us, we're essential to the success of this thing. And so the way we want to interact with our vehicles is key. So it'll be interesting to hear now from Mark Fosmoen. Now, he is the Director of North American Customer Engineering for Visteon. As you can see, there's a blank here. But if you go to our website, you can get his full biography. And so with that, Mark, please take it away.
Excellent. Thank you, Gary. Thank you. Really appreciate the opportunity to be here. A lot of very insightful presentations over today and last night. And I think it was a terrific presentation, Glen, because I think there's a lot of synergies here we see as in the automotive space between a lot of what we consider to be traditional tier one or automotive suppliers. So a little bit of background on me. I've been in the automotive industry for 24 years, electronics the whole time. And with Visteon, for those of you who don't know, we started out as a quite large supplier, part of Ford. But over the last several years, we've really consolidated. And now we're focused solely on cockpit electronics, right? So with that in mind, what I'd like to do is take you through a couple of the impacts that we see from an engineering perspective on the change in the industry, the move towards, you know, automated, autonomous, and also ADAS in the industry. And those being, you know, engineering skill changes that we need internally and with our partnerships, as well as the design and development challenges we see in the short term, and also what we need to do from a leadership and a structure perspective to make sure that we're successful. And as was noted earlier, you know, it's a very fast, very quickly evolving industry, so we can't just sit still and have the status quo on how we manage and how we drive our engineering disciplines. So firstly, engineering skills and expertise impacts. These are pretty high-level bullet points, but there's a lot of detail, I think, behind these, and everyone would agree that, you know, as noted earlier, 80% of our effort in ED&D on components and modules we supply now is software. So we really need to look around the industry, and we need to actually, I'll call it, an upgrade in our skills and our knowledge. And I don't mean by taking people that are currently in and pushing them out, but it means continuous education. It means looking at hiring people from either different disciplines, different regions, and different industries. And I think, obviously, like a lot of other companies, you'll see announcements of mergers and acquisitions or partnerships or opening of offices in areas that wouldn't be traditionally a tier one location. The other one is software architectural partitioning and security. And I'll get into a couple of these in a little bit more detail later. But within software, what's really interesting is, obviously, is the biggest part of our modules today. What we found from a expertise and knowledge perspective is it's no longer any good to just have somebody write a piece of software that meets requirements. We have to trace this all the way back through development of new tools, knowledge on those tools, modeling tools is key to us now. So from a traceability, a SPICE compliance, and being able to meet all of our requirements and exceed the customer's expectations, we're starting all the way back and doing low-level modeling from architectures, design elements, and be able to trace that right down through lines of code all the way back up to the customer requirements and the validation cycles. So I think that's a key skill upgrade that we need going forward. The next one is cybersecurity. I'll have a couple slides further on about that, but we need software developers and hardware developers that really understand the impacts of security, whether it be hardware and SHE requirements, or whether it be OS level, application level, or infrastructure level security, whether it be, and that's networked and internal. And the last one is connectivity infrastructure expertise. And by that, really it's about making sure that we understand the high speed external and internal networks from a security perspective. We're gonna have to have obviously an upgrade in our skill sets there. So strategic partnerships, I think it was mentioned earlier. I don't think any of us can do this alone. We see this a very collaborative environment. We don't think that having a fully proprietary or internal or organic development is really affordable anymore, and is probably prohibitive from a leveraging across the industry. We see a lot of our customers don't want proprietary solutions. They want more open solutions. And I think you'll see this in Visteon's announcement at CES this year in our new infotainment platform, where we do have a new infotainment platform, but it's really more of that. It's a platform that allows for more open structure, third-party software to sit on top of it in a secure domain. Another piece of that is the domain controllers. What you'll see in our industry going forward is domains that were separate before, like instrument clusters, infotainment, TCUs, et cetera. Those are gonna start coming together as the SoCs are more powerful and capable to allow that domain integration. We already have several large programs in development in that area in domain controllers, where we're integrating clusters, infotainment, connectivity into a single domain and driving multiple displays, 2, 3, 4. But with that comes a lot of engineering disciplines and engineering challenges, which I'll get into shortly here. And the last piece here, the last two pieces, I guess, really is one of them is participation in university consortiums, government involvement, and we have a few of those going on, and they're really, really important. Even if you're not going to be developing, a vehicle-level system, if it's a component, you still have to have knowledge of how that component interacts with the rest of the systems and how it interacts in the vehicle in the real environment. And that's why we're involved in some projects in the UK and in France. And in France, particularly, we have one with the French government on the user's interface, and I think Dave touched on this earlier, about the experience, not so much the graphical content or the menu structure, but the user's experience with the UI in a automated or autonomous environment. And the last one is the IC partnerships to ensure a life cycle, truly life cycle managed. Part of the development process is that we need to get higher leverage of our assets going forward. We can't afford to spend $30, $40 million on a one cycle, and as the SoC families move ahead, we can't afford to spend it again. So we need tight partnerships and collaboration with hardware and software suppliers to make sure those assets are reusable in the future. And next one. So design and development challenges. I'm gonna quickly go through these four areas. And I'll start with software considerations for reliability. Simple slide, three big icons, but in our view, super, super important. So first one, system monitoring and health management. So in the past, again, we would have requirements and specifications, and we would design to them from a software perspective. And how we're evolving very, very quickly, and we've already started to launch some products in this realm with some of our customers. And I'll give an example that's quite self-contained to a single module, but our software architectures have to change, right? And one way we're doing that is to do full module monitoring, which is the first step, and then management. So many, many people are doing monitoring. So you can look at when a process checks in and how many threads you have being monitored. So on a recent system, for example, there's 25 or 30 processes within an instrument cluster for us. and 165 threads, for instance. We can monitor all of them, but to be able to manage them and take action against them, but to be able to manage them is the trick. So where we're moving to be able to restart individual threads and individual processes within our software when a component, when I say a component, I mean a software component, checks in late, doesn't check in, or has a check-in of two or three times, whatever we deem configurable, as a need to be able to restart that process. And the net effect to the consumer is, what they'll see going forward is possibly a very, very short glitch, or maybe a 1 second blip versus today, some modules will do a restart, right? Or you do a reset, and it could be several seconds before the system comes back. So, coupled right with the system monitoring health management comes data integrity. So the minute I start doing process restarts, threads restarts through a health monitoring and health management system, I have to have data integrity, right? So again, in past software architectures, there was a lot of point-to-point data handling, a little less possibly secure. But I think what you're gonna see going forward is more data pooling and a data pool architectures. But with that comes the need for data integrity and data storage. So what we've been doing and what you'll see happening is you'll have to have data pools and integrity and highly secure data so that when you do restart a process or a thread, I can access to that dynamic data very quickly, and I know that it's secure, so I can come back to the exact same place where I left off. And the user in a automated or an autonomous system sees very, very little impact. Also along that same lines with data integrity and management and storage, is that I think what we're gonna see is more redundancy. So in a lot of systems today, again, thinking from a component and a module within this ecosystem of the ADAS system, modules tended to work, you know, in a single domain. And if you did have to restart a process or a thread, if it's a secure or a highly user interface dependable thread, in the future, what we'll see is we're gonna have possibly redundancies of processes running in parallel with synchronized data. So if one starts to lag, doesn't check in on time, it's late by 20 milliseconds, we can jump to the parallel process, running that process with synchronized data. And the last piece is security. With security, I'm gonna drive maybe a little bit deeper. To us, or to myself, I think this is one of the most important pieces as we move forward in this very exciting, but also very I think difficult area is how do we ensure that we keep our systems safe? When you take your hands off the wheel, or if you're playing with your 20-inch panel next to you, and you're not really necessarily fully engaged in the road, we have to make sure that it's extremely secure and the systems are running, again, maybe redundant processes with data integrity. And the biggest thing is secure. And it's a bit frustrating, but obviously as we get towards this point, there's increased attractiveness for people out there to maliciously try to attack the vehicles and for a lot of different goals. And I won't list them off, but you all know what they are. Some of them are just to purely disrupt us, and some of them are to gain access to data and to steal that data. Some of those potential entrance points, mentioned earlier OTA, it's absolutely coming. Obviously, it's already there in many systems, but it's gonna be more prolific. So with software updates, it's also another point of entrance, and we have to be extremely careful about how those things are encrypted and how they are gonna be managed. Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, and obviously the normal OBD2 and CAN and other Ethernet and most buses. So the lines of defense. So obviously a lot of entrance points for this. So I think the primary lines of defense for us, we have to look at this as a system and build it out, okay? A lot of people look at security, and the lines of defense is just, I put my application on, I have an encrypted file, hashing with some verification, but we look at this as a series of protections, right? Starts at the interfaces. What are those entrances? And we have to build firewalls, and we have to have data integrity and validation across those firewalls. And then we have, obviously, the application layer of code. Well, obviously, we want to make sure that we have secure application-to-application, process-to-process communications, and people aren't disrupting those applications because it could be a user interface. It could be a warning that goes up or doesn't go up. And obviously, as we drive down through the OSs, and the virtualization. They get a little more difficult, but this is also where some of the third party and collaboration comes in. We've built out our own hypervisor, for instance. We're launching that with a large German customer next year. But going forward, we'll utilize that, but we'll also use third-party virtualizations, whether it be a bare metal virtualizer or whether it be something that's hardened up for our particular domain. And obviously, even all the way down to the hardware level, almost all of us know that the OEMs require some form of SHE hardware security as well. So that was more software-centric. And then I think what I'm kind of going through is some of the challenges we've seen in, again, this domain is we have to harden up our systems. In addition to that, what we see is that with the high level of sensor inputs and the amount of user interfaces that we see growing, larger displays, higher resolution, consumers want to interact a little bit more with their systems. We have modules now that are driving 3 and 4 displays. We have a piece of business that we're working on now that there's we're supplying 9 different displays in the vehicle, one of which is, they're greater than 17 inches in size. So the impact to us as in the supply base for that is really that we're integrating much, much larger SoCs, much larger and several memory devices. Our PWBs are getting far denser, much higher layer count as we're all aware of because the packaging space is at a premium. And what it does for us is it creates the demand for greater knowledge and greater skills on EMC and signal integrity experts within our electrical engineering team, obviously to be able to dissipate some of that power more efficiently and also to help us to, we'll call it, separate some of those domains. So what we've seen is the need to be able to separate, for instance, TFT panel power dissipation from our electrical board dissipation. We do that through mechanical and electrical domain separation. Also, with the quantity and the resolution of these displays going up, and the size of them as well, we also have a demand from a UI perspective for much, much brighter displays, going through possibly multiple panels, going through panels which have smoke on them. With HUDs, for instance, having to compensate for washout and brightness, we have 8,000. Nit displays, we have 3,000 nit displays, and based on that, we have much, much higher dissipation requirements. We have programs in flight now that we're having to dissipate, 24 to 28 watts of power in a simple instrument cluster. They happen to be on Ethernet and a lot of other things, but still, that's 2 to 3 times more than what we saw a few years ago. And the reason I'm kind of going through this is that we see this getting even bigger in the next 3 to 4 years, because obviously the displays and the user interactions are going to get more complicated. So some of the impacts to us are, we really are starting to look at unique thermal management techniques. We're looking at thermally conductive plastics. We're looking at, again, separation of thermal zones. So we want to actually isolate TFTs from our power electronics, much, much larger power supplies. So we're trying to take and separate those zones, as you can kind of see here. One example is the display on the top where there's 14 watts of power we have to dissipate from the display, where the pickup zones for that are 4 very small little tiny pickup zones. And to do that, we have to be able to isolate that from our PWB, get that heat out from within the vehicle environment that we're in, and we have a very constrained rise over ambient temperatures that we have to work within. So these are some of the challenges that I think come along with the ADAS environment as we enhance the user interfaces. So mentioned a little bit about it maybe in the software area, but I think it was Andy Smart that mentioned this earlier about validation and verification. And to me, this is one of the most important parts about this growth in security, in the software that we're gonna have to develop, is how we are going to verify the component and the system. So I'll touch on the bottom point here in this time, which is basically where we see, again, more skills and advancement needed is in AI and some of the learning algorithms, not necessarily, for instance, on internalized algorithms, but on our systems and software validation. So you think about how we test today. Most suppliers test to the specs. Do I meet the spec? Don't I meet the spec? That's no longer any good when we're talking about ADAS and automated driving. We need to test beyond the boundary of the specifications, and we need to use AI and some of the deep learning algorithms to look at building out test scripts that can go to the voltage extremes, that can go to the thermal extremes, and can take and overload the system from a data bandwidth perspective. And once you've ran a test 1,000 times, the system should learn that I don't need to run that same test again. I need to take that test, I need to augment it, and augment it, and augment it, so that I stress our system till it breaks. And to me, that's where the component and the system validation needs to go. We can't test to the requirements, we have to test well beyond those requirements to the boundary conditions. Very, very briefly, I think I mentioned most of these, but from a leadership and a structure perspective, I think we all need to change. It's been a very dynamic environment. We have to obviously be bold and fast, but to the last point, we need to be extremely, extremely thorough. These are super important systems, and obviously we have to make sure for our OEM customers they do not fail. And so I think the thorough is a key attribute there. And the last part is on structural. We've gone through a pretty big transformation. Visteon recently, we went from a quite large monolithic groups. We had, you know, 2,000 or 3,000 people in software and, you know, 400 or 500 people in electrical and mechanical. We started to break those groups down into delivery teams and core centers of excellence or competencies. And those groups are focused on their own technology development within a very small domain. It might be an OS, it might be a BSP team, it might be a cybersecurity team. And those teams are focused on just that technology and the roadmap, and the delivery teams can take and use those just like we would from an outside supplier or a third party into our program deliveries. So just in summary, I think we're excited about it as a Visteon, as a tier one. A lot of challenges for us as a component supplier and as a system supplier. And I think I mentioned all these, but the biggest thing for us is it's going to require an evolution of our skills. We have to look outside of our current domain, our current hiring strategies. We absolutely need the partnerships and the domain experts to come and be grown a little bit in-house, but also to partner with our IC and our software suppliers. And the last part is extremely important, which is we need our leadership teams for all of our companies to understand that we have to instill discipline and within our processes to make sure that these things are absolutely robust and flawless, because that's what our customers expect. You know, a single event in the industry is unacceptable, at least from a supply perspective. And I think that's all. Thank you.
So I think I can say on behalf of all of us who drive that we really hope that all the testing is done well beyond the requirements, because that's absolutely essential. So our next speaker is Andreas. Andreas, Cisco. So I thought, you know, that Glen DeVos would be in Troy, and so I said to Andreas, I said, oh, so you must be in California, huh? He goes, no, I'm in Detroit. So strange world. So Andreas.
Thank you. Very much, Gary. So good afternoon. I'm literally living the dream because I just flew in last night from Melbourne, 30 hours. So I'm not really sure whether I'm still dreaming about this or whether I'm here. I'm also living the dream in another way, because I just left Cisco. And so I'm allowed now to just work on fun stuff and also work only with fun people. But for all of us here to make this dream come through, I chose to change the topic a little bit, not talk about Cisco technology, pardon, but talk about money. Some of you may have seen my kind of earlier assessment of how much money is in it for all of us if we connect vehicles. That was in 2011, and I came up with the $1,400 per vehicle per year that we can make. But since then, I had the privilege to work with many of you, and you shared your great insights with me, and I came to conclude that the money that is in it for us and the money that will pay for all of us to make our dream come through, that we saw here in many aspects today, is significantly larger. So I looked at over 100 studies and created about 450 impacts of how everything you saw today is going to turn into money. And not only turn into money, but I also evaluated who is winning and who is losing. So give me a couple of minutes to share some of the highlights of this. So overall, the net present value of what we can create together here globally is about $5 trillion. $1.6 trillion of this is trucks, everything moving big vehicles, and $3.4 trillion of this is passenger vehicles. Interestingly, if you look at what is driving this, it is actually advanced driver assist systems for cars plus mobility as a service, first and foremost. Whereas for trucks, it is primarily ITS and then fleet management, and that's connected fleet management. These are the key drivers of value for these two domains. What this chart also shows very nicely, and this is something that I picked up from Ray Kurzweil, who was quoted before as well, it's exponential innovation that is happening here, because the confluence of all these technologies are accelerating the pace at which we have to innovate to make all this happen. If you then look at the actual value that is being created, it's actually $11.4 trillion. The value that is migrating from one group of stakeholders to another is $6.4 trillion. That gives you the net of $5 trillion. And the effects that I distinguished here are cost reduction, gross margin increase, and cost avoidance. Cost avoidance is something that doesn't necessarily hit the bottom line of an enterprise. And on the other side, we have gross margin reduction and cost increase, and the net of this gives you the effect of $5 trillion. If you look at some of the examples, you see that mobility will be less costly. You will see that insurance will be less costly. On the other side, you will see new businesses emerge. So mobility as a service is a new business that is emerging that will create value. But on the negative side, you have already seen in New York, taxi prices are going to decrease. So there's also a group of stakeholders that is going to lose. We will see insurance premiums go down, because if you have less crashes, insurance premiums go down. And if we don't have crashes, dealers and lawyers will also lose some money. On the other hand, we have to pay for all these systems. So contrary to popular belief, and I will show this on the next slide, automakers are actually set to win. But who are the winners and the losers? The biggest winner, and that's really important to understand here, is society at large. So more than half, or actually more or less exactly half, of the value created is societal value. And I will explain on the next two slides what that really is. But interestingly, the owner of vehicles, and this in particular are fleet owners of vehicles, will gain. Insurance companies will gain. Auto companies will gain. But only if they turn this opportunity around with the right strategies. Because if you just stay put and stay true to what you're doing right now, you're not necessarily going to gain like many of the stakeholders here. On the other side, the $0.7 trillion of losers are minuscule compared to the gains that we can make. Yes, we will lose jobs where people are driving trucks, where people are driving taxis, but the losses here, as I will show later on, are substantially lower than the gains that we can make on the other side. But societal value. So I also looked at studies that showed how many kind of crashes can we actually prevent, how many injuries can we prevent. And interestingly, if you face this in with the very slow penetration rates of ADAS or autonomous, you come to substantially lower numbers of crashes or injuries or debt or kind of casualties that can be prevented. It's actually over 10 years about 1 million people globally that we can save lives for. The more interesting result, which I found really striking, was that we will save 250 billion hours. And just to put it into perspective, that's 150 million work years, 30 million years, or 400,000 lifetimes. And this time is worth a lot. If you increase the penetration, just to give you an impression of how big of a lever we have here, if you increase vehicle penetration just by 1% of autonomous ADAS, et cetera, the increase in crashes prevented, the increase in injuries prevented, and more importantly, the increase in hours saved is fundamental. It's huge. Yeah, so that means for policymakers, whoever drives policies that make this transition happen faster will have a tremendous impact on society and the value that we can create. Why is that? Because time is the only thing that nobody can give us back, but it's also 580 hours per year here in North America, as one example, out of which a little more than 100 hours are traffic inefficiencies. That's looking for parking, that's sitting in congestion, and that is also standing in front of traffic lights. So if we connect vehicles, that's the first step where we can generate value with this. The next level is if we have assisted driving. So we can suddenly do more things, specifically in city traffic when you're congested, and kind of if your vehicle takes over some of the driving tasks, you can do a little bit more. But ultimately, it is when you have an autonomous vehicle, and on the right-hand side, you see that each vehicle is worth about $3,360, and that is true gross margin. This is not a revenue, this is gross margin, hits the bottom line. And that's the amount of time that everyone in this room, in North America at least, spends consuming media, or spends shopping online, or spends working during a regular year of time. So that's why the Googles and the Apples of this world are so keen to get a foot in the door of a vehicle. There's a tremendous value to be gained. On the societal side too, it's also a tremendous impact on the environment, as you can imagine. And I try to kind of give an example of how much fuel we can actually save. The amount of fuel we can save equals a line of trucks, 5.8 million trucks, two times around the globe. That's the amount of fuel we can save. On the other side, if we look at the emissions, and we look at the largest ship ever built, it's the Nok Navis, it's about 1,500 supertankers. Yeah, so that's a lot of pollution. We here in North America, we are blessed because we don't have the problems that people in Shanghai have, for instance, or Beijing. If you ever were there, it is just mind-bogglingly bad. But it's a tremendous impact specifically on these parts of the world. The other element that we tend to overlook is we are in luck because we can afford a car. But with mobility as a service and the cost of transportation going down 75% per mile, yeah, so instead of a dollar per mile roundabout all cost in, we only pay about 25 cents per mile, we can make 1.7 billion people mobile in the world. And that will primarily happen in parts of the world like Asia or Africa. This is where kind of the future market for mobility as a service lies. This is why an investment of Apple in Didi is most likely more successful than an investment of GM in Lyft. The other element is was also interesting. There's a lot of talk about, oh my God, if this happens, mobility as a service, we will not sell cars anymore. Interestingly, at a penetration rate of 10% mobility as a service vehicles in the overall vehicle population, yes, we are going to sell less cars in North America, but the entire vehicle population is only going down by roundabout, if you look at this here, between 15 and 20 million of a 250 million vehicle park. Don't forget that. So the reduction here is kind of overseeable. But on the other hand, the mobility as a service fleets in parts of the world where people need mobility will go up substantially. So it's a shift from personal ownership in this part of the world to fleet ownership in the other part of the world. If you then also look at the jobs being created through this, the net is about 60 million jobs globally that will be created through this emergence of new industries. The little kind of space here at the bottom that you see are the jobs that will be lost. Jobs for drivers, jobs for truck drivers or taxi drivers, legal jobs or jobs where people repair cars. Interestingly, if you look at this based on kind of the factors that are fundamentally different in the world, car ownership, who can afford to own a car, how expensive is it to buy fuel, level of congestion do we have, what level of crashes do we have in the different parts of the world, there is no one-size-fits-all strategy. So you need to look at it region by region and push different policies across those regions to gain or to make the best impact for the money that you invest. And if you look at the biggest kind of winners in this, it's really Asia Pacific, followed by Western Europe. Driving a car is significantly more expensive in Europe than it is here in North America. And only number three is North America. That's why the pressure to act in this country is somewhat lower than the pressure to act in the other parts of the world. And in closing, we just kind of just talked about the digitization of road transportation on a global basis. If you look at the same data through the lens of the various stakeholders, you see kind of different aspects that you need to put into your strategy to win, or things that you need to be observant about not to lose too much. The regional comparison and also the regional strategies are also fundamentally different. So for policymakers, that means that everything you do to push mobility as a service, to help the Ubers and the Lyfts of this world to come to your cities is actually beneficial, because it makes people mobile, it allows people to get to jobs, it allows people to get to healthcare, and the more you move into the poorer parts of the world, the more the statement holds true. With this, I thank you very much for your attention and pass it back on to Gary.
Shocking, $5 trillion. I think we all need to get a raise. I'm going to talk to my boss about that after this. Our next presenter is Danny Shapiro. He's the Senior Director of Automotive for NVIDIA. Throughout the day, we've heard NVIDIA mentioned by a number of presenters, and I can't even begin to explain their technology, and you know, my job is to explain technology, and it's still something beyond me. So I think that we're going to see from Danny something that will be quite amazing. So, Danny.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon. It's great to be here again in Detroit. I used to actually come out here a lot, and part of the challenge was actually getting meetings with automakers, and now essentially they all have come out to us in Silicon Valley, and they've all, of course, you guys have created offices, and so it's rare that I find myself here, but again, it's great to be back. What I wanted to talk about is sort of a whole new way of creating self-driving cars. And I think we've been talking a lot about various levels of automation. At the core of all this now is artificial intelligence. This has really been kind of a push forward, and it's not just happening in the automotive space. It's a whole new computing model. I mean, if we sort of look at how industry trends over the last several decades have progressed, right? In computing, we had the PC and the internet, right? And this has kind of gave access to a whole new way of doing business, a whole new way of commerce, a whole new way of computing. A decade later, with the iPhone and the cloud, again, we sort of moved into a whole new computing model, right? People running apps on their phone, data connection to the cloud. We're doing it again right now. We're right in the middle. We're just really actually starting to kind of roll these things out, but we've been working on it for years, where artificial intelligence is changing how everything is done. Now, if you guys, right now, if you're not looking at deep learning, if you're not looking at how artificial intelligence is going to play a role in your business, whether it's finance side, whether it's engineering, whether it's retail, you're going to be left behind. So I think the key thing here is now it's IoT, it's robotics, it's automated vehicles, but it goes well beyond this. So again, deep learning is really taking over. There's this whole new model of what's happening really in this space now. So this GPU computing, the graphics processing unit, something we invented decades ago, now has a whole new life. So graphics is still big, it's still a big part of our company, but we're putting GPUs everywhere. They're not just in PCs, they're in mobile devices, they're in the cloud, they're in the data centers, and they're in the car as well. Essentially, there's this process by which, though, you first train a system, and that happens in the data center, you create a neural net model, and then you actually deploy this into a vehicle or another object. I think we saw a little bit about this discussed earlier. This is this whole cycle, and it continues. And we're using now the learnings to continually make our systems smarter and smarter and smarter. You guys experience this every day. If you use any of these apps, there's GPUs in the back end in the cloud that are doing the processing. You talk to Siri, that's deep learning running on NVIDIA GPUs. You use Netflix, the recommendation engines, Google searches. I mean, the list just goes on and on. All of the major internet companies or service companies are now using deep learning in the back end, processing everything. So we've talked about, you know, transportation. It's, you know, by our calculations, actually the whole transportation industry is about $10 trillion. So not just the vehicles, but all the services and all the commerce that it enables. This is truly going to be transformed now as we have a whole new type of way of operating these vehicles, whether they're cars, whether they're trucks, whether they're shuttles, Hyperloop, whatever it may be. Kind of at the fundamental level now is deep learning, this form of artificial intelligence, where we're not programming a system to do something, but the system is learning, and actually data is creating the software itself. So, you know, I think we're not going to go into great detail, but as we break down the process of figuring out how a car can drive on its own, there's some basics of robotics that, again, we didn't invent, but we're helping to perfect, which is you have to, first of all, sense and perceive the surroundings. You have to understand where you are, so localization. We saw some examples of this early on this morning with the SLAM demonstration. And then, so we sense, we have to plan, and then we act. So these are the fundamentals of robotics. And again, instead of hard coding everything, because there actually is no way to write software that can account for the infinite number of possibilities of what can happen when you're driving, we use artificial intelligence. So as we've seen, right, driving is very complex. Some of the earlier videos today were great examples. Here's just a couple of images of the unpredictability and the different kinds of conditions that you encounter every day. So there might be things obscuring the lane markings. There might be people that are out there, whether they're pedestrians or whether police officer. There's cyclists that can, or other drivers that can operate erratically. School buses, right? There's certain rules, whether they're written or not, you observe, and there's certain behavior that you take advantage of when you're driving as a human, that it's really hard to translate that into actual code for a self-driving car. So again, what we're focused on doing is bringing a technology to market that will enable car companies, tier ones, startup companies to build self-driving cars. So at CES, we introduced our Drive PX solution. So this is, again, about the size of a license plate. This system delivers over 20 trillion operations per second. So this is a true supercomputer. If we go back a decade, that supercomputer would probably take up this entire room and consume about 500,000 watts of power and require an air conditioning system that probably was another 500,000 watts to cool it down. So we've basically been able to shrink this down into the size of a license plate. So our system is a platform, right? We're not creating a black box, because what we've discovered is every single automaker has their own idea of what automated driving is all about. They're using different sensors, cameras, radar, LiDAR, ultrasonics. So again, this development platform is now being used by over 80 different automakers, tier one suppliers, and startup companies, both in the Valley, in Germany, in Japan, here in Detroit. And each of them are able to build their systems on top of this platform to enable it to do whatever it is they need. Again, various levels of automation, whether it's a fully self-driving car or something with a highway autopilot. We've also essentially created a platform from a software perspective. We've heard how critical software is, but there's no need for everybody to go out and reinvent every line of code. So we provide a lot of tools and libraries and routines, all the basic framework and fundamentals to create these neural networks. And so what we've done is actually created a lot of reference neural nets. So we're training a system how to recognize objects. We do this by feeding it massive amounts of information. So we train it how to recognize pedestrians, cars, trucks, bicycles. We can train it to recognize signs. We can train it to recognize lanes. And that's kind of our drive net. But we've also done some work with some other algorithms to be able to recognize free space or recognize different types of situations that are the corner cases. You know, we talk about how many millions of miles that these cars have driven, but the reality is most of those miles of driving are just basic highway miles, or even if they're city miles, they're sort of boring miles. And the key thing is to be able to understand what to do in those emergency situations. So having a lot of miles isn't just enough. What you need are critical miles. And so it's a combination of actually driven miles and simulated miles to be able to represent these situations where the ball rolls into the road, or a cyclist darts out in front of the car, or a car turns in front, et cetera. So what we've done, again, is provided this whole framework for you to build applications on, and that includes both sort of the brains of the car, the logic of what's going to happen in these situations, but then, as we've heard, the communication back to the driver, or the passengers of the car, is pretty critical. So we have taken all the work we've done on the infotainment side and the digital cockpit side and integrated that so that the car is able to communicate back to the driver, give you a sense of confidence that the car sees things. The example here on the screen is one of our prototypes that, again, takes the sensors, all that information. We build a three-dimensional model of everything that's going on around the car. We're tracking all these different objects. And then we're able to present that view back to the driver so they know exactly what the car sees, and they have the confidence in knowing that the car will do the right thing. In this case, you can eliminate your mirrors now. You have full 360-degree awareness around your car, and you can see who's in your blind spot without ever having to look in a mirror. A lot of these tools now are being used, as I mentioned, by others. One of the things I kind of wanted to give a shout out to is Udacity. So this is Sebastian Thrun's new venture. It's been around a couple of years. He's doing online education. He was part of the DARPA Grand Challenge. He was sort of the founder of Google's self-driving car group. And so now he's teaching all these different types of courses, the newest one being a degree for a self-driving car engineer. So this was just launched about 2 weeks ago at TechCrunch. And the course actually starts, I think, in another week or two. So in 2 weeks, they had over 11,000 engineers sign up to take this class. Now, they only have 250 slots, so not sure how they're going to figure it out. But along with Mercedes, Auto, we are participating with them, developing the content for this course and providing the systems. So all these potentially new self-driving car engineers are learning what it takes to develop a self-driving car, learning about deep learning, computer vision, and all the kind of command and controls that they'll need to do. So for all of you that are looking to hire people in this space, there's going to be these waves of engineers that are now going to come out understanding what's required to develop self-driving technologies. So some of the things that they're going to be working on and that we've been doing in our labs, again, are training neural networks to be able to recognize different parts of the self-driving pipeline and equations that are required for that. So here's just a couple of examples I just wanted to show. The kind of processing that takes place inside the vehicle. On the left, again, is a free space algorithm. We're not now training it to detect specific objects, but to recognize where the open space on the road is. Again, this is essentially how we all drive. You're not going through a checklist saying, is there another car in front of me? No. Is there a bike in front of me? No. Is there a pedestrian? But you actually look and you observe the entire surroundings and you drive where it's safe to drive. The other example I'm showing is our ability to detect not just the objects, but extract from two-dimensional imagery, the video, and extract a whole three-dimensional representation of the car. So we need to know the complete volume of the other obstacles on the road. So bicycles obviously take up less volume than cars do, than trucks do. So once we start to combine all these different types of information coming in, we get a very accurate understanding of what's going on around our car. Deep learning is now everywhere. All of these companies and many, many more that we're not allowed to talk about yet are using deep learning in their self-driving car efforts. So it's really exciting to see the kinds of development that's going on in the labs out in Silicon Valley, in the labs here, and around the world. And you can see it's a whole range of different companies. Some of the programs then with actual vehicles on the road today kind of run the gamut. We just announced work with Baidu out in China, creating a whole cloud-to-car solution there for mapping and autonomous vehicles. Nutonomy is in Singapore. Volvo's rolling out their Drive Me program in Sweden and then the UK and China. TomTom doing a lot of cloud-based mapping to the vehicle. These are the same themes we've been talking about all day, where communication is, of course, key. It's not a requirement for autonomy, but it really makes it a lot, lot better. In the WePods, we actually were just in Amsterdam a couple weeks ago for our GPU technology conference, and we had the WePods driving people all around the streets out front of the convention center. So there's a huge amount of work going on, and one of the things I just wanted to do is show you just a couple of examples of the kind of research and where we're at. This is Mercedes' team working with deep learning, and this is kind of the classic or traditional approach where they've trained a neural net how to understand and recognize different types of objects. So as we're driving through, instantly we can infer what's a car, what's a bike, what's a pedestrian, what's a street sign. We're able to then take all that training, though, and run it through a different type of algorithm, and at the per pixel level now, we can analyze that video and understand and classify all these different objects in the scene. And so this view becomes very, very important in that it helps us understand, well, what is the roadway, right? Where is the open space? And so purple road, blue sidewalk, orange cars, yellow signs, et cetera. Now, no one is ever going to see this, of course, but we use this as a way to sort of debug and tune the system to understand, again, what parts of the algorithms are working and what needs to be refined. The power, though, of deep learning is pretty amazing in that this is work we've done with Audi. They initially trained the system how to recognize cars in clear weather, and we then took this out in a snowstorm. And you can see they're able to detect the cars on the roadway far out in the horizon in really bad visibility. And essentially now we're achieving superhuman levels of perception. We're able to train these systems to be much more accurate than you or I could be. The power of this, too, is really apparent. Audi had been spending 2 years with a smart camera company developing a system to recognize all the German street signs. And part of the reason it took so long is, I mean, there's a lot of street signs, but they were actually writing computer vision code to detect the features and sort of nuances of each of the signs, the shape, the color, the words. So we came along with a deep learning system that showed them what they can do. Essentially, a workstation, they loaded it with their database of all the signs and essentially the vocabulary. They trained the system. They spent 4 hours training. After those 4 hours, they were able to achieve a better level of perception than 2 years of development. So this was, again, a huge aha moment. It basically woke them up and realized how powerful deep learning is. And now the fact that they have to do this in all these different countries. You know, in Japan, the signs are totally different. They don't have to code to be able to read the Japanese signs, but rather feed the data in, and it's good to go. So this leads to kind of the final thing I wanted to show you. This is some work that we're doing out in our autonomous lab out in New Jersey. We have a team there. And this is now not just training it how to recognize lane markings, or not just training it how to recognize people or recognize signs, but instead something that's called end-to-end deep learning. We essentially have cameras on the car, and we're taking that video input in, and we're mapping that to the steering wheel. And so we do a lot of test drives, and we're essentially teaching the car how to recognize different scenarios, different situations, and take the appropriate action. So initially, we train the car with 3,000 miles of driving, and then let it perform. And what I want to do is just show you, there's a little bit of audio on this, so hopefully that'll come through. So the car's called BB-8, that's just our nickname. So it's like the teenager the first time we took it out. It's never driven before. It doesn't know what to do. But by driving it around different situations, then it learns where it can drive and where it shouldn't drive. And a critical thing here is no lane markings, it doesn't care, it doesn't require them. As was mentioned earlier, there's going to be the capability of fleet learning here, right? So the more cars you have in your fleet, the more they're out there observing things, they're going to be able to communicate that back to the cloud, and the whole fleet will be able to get smarter and smarter. Now, none of this is your car learns based on you driving, but rather we have professional drivers teaching it, and then the collection of other data is all aggregated. So again, this is still at the research phase. We're not advocating all you need is 3,000 miles of driving. But what we're going to find very quickly is how much this technique can be used combined with other neural nets. There might be multiple neural nets running in the car that have different functions that are looking out for different things. And the last thing I wanted to show you, and this is going to be a really exciting thing happening later this year and into next year, is RoboRace. So this is part of the Formula E circuit. This is a whole series of race cars. There are 20 different cars, but they all look like this, right? They all have the same batteries, the same motors, the same design. The only thing that's different is the paint and the software. So each of these will have the Drive PX2 inside, and 10 teams will basically be developing code, writing different computer vision and AI algorithms to race these cars at very high speed around the track. So it's going to be a global event and should be really exciting. So with that, I just want to like to close and again stress how critical deep learning and AI is going to be, not just for autonomous vehicles, but in healthcare, in finance, in energy. And if you're not thinking about it, you should be. Thanks.
That was interesting to hear about the edge cases. There's this somewhat famous story that the Google people say that their car encountered an old woman in a wheelchair with a broom chasing a duck, okay? And obviously their autonomous car didn't work out so well under that situation. Okay, so the final presenter in this session is Barbara Wendling, who works for Mercedes-Benz R&D. She's in testing and regulatory affairs. We saw some video of Mercedes on Danny's presentation. So, Barbara, please.
Thank you. OK, Okay, so we're going to switch gears a little bit. I'm actually speaking today on behalf of SAE rather than Mercedes, although, of course, I am employed by Mercedes. And I'm going to get a little bit pedantic here. I apologize for that and talk about SAE J3016, which is a standard for taxonomy and terms related to automated driving. Hopefully, you'll find it useful. So we began the work in 2011 and had our first review of that document in 2012, a couple of formal ballots, and published the first version in January of 2014. We almost immediately began revising the document, however, because it was quickly picked up and was being used in international regulatory discussions under Working Party 29, and a couple of large joint government and industry projects, one in Europe called Adaptive and another here in the US called Crash Avoidance Metrics Partnership, AVR project. And we had lessons learned from that. Both of those projects used this the original taxonomy, but found some inconsistencies and some holes in it, such that we then plugged with the latest version of the document, which was just published at the end of the month. The ground rules for the revision that we just did were that we would keep the same levels, the same level names, and the same functional differentiators for the levels in the same Table 1 framework that people were already familiar with. But we did do a lot of clarification, and a lot more rationalization was added to the document. Why do levels and language matter? Well, because they clarify the scope. That's particularly important for laws, regulations, and standards and the like. They also clarify the role of the driver, if any, and they provide a framework for assigning things like requirements and criteria. The Camp AVR project that I mentioned, for example, assigns safety principles by level, or develops safety principles by level. And they also facilitate communications. At the outset of the automated driving revolution, if you will, in 2010, it was very difficult to even talk about this subject because we were frequently using the same words to mean different things. So this was an attempt to get a handle on that. Also provides a very useful shorthand. And for those of us who have to speak and write about this topic frequently, that's worth a lot. And finally, it has been picked up internationally and most recently by the US DOT. It's been referenced in their AV guidelines that were published on the 20th of September. So, SAE, this taxonomy classifies driving automation systems, and driving automation systems, unlike other automation systems on the vehicle, are those that perform part or all of a dynamic driving task on a sustained basis. And on a sustained basis means that it controls both between and across events occurring in traffic, and thus it fundamentally changes the driver's role. So there are lots of other automated systems on vehicles, highly sophisticated, but they're not driving automation. For example, automated emergency braking, electronic stability control, these are automation systems, but they are not automated driving systems because they don't control between and across events. Similarly, conventional cruise control doesn't control to events at all. So again, not a driving automation system. So this taxonomy actually classifies features, driving automation features, not systems per se. These are a list of all of the supporting terms in the document. I'm not going to go through all of them. Obviously, we'd be here all day. I just wanted to show you what's in there and encourage you to pick up the document and read it. I am going to go through a few of the key supporting terms just because they're needed to understand the levels. But these are just paraphrased definitions. The document goes into more detail, obviously. So the dynamic driving task is the operational and tactical aspects of the driving task minus the strategic aspects. And the strategic aspects are things like determining whether, when, and where to go. Automated driving system is a reserved term for level 3 through 5. These are systems that are capable of performing the complete dynamic driving task on a sustained basis. The generic term for driving automation systems, level 1 through 5, is driving automation system. And yeah, it's a little confusing, but we reduce automated driving system to its acronym ADS. We don't do that with driving automation system, the generic term. The DDT fallback is a separate function. This is what happens if there's a malfunction or if the vehicle goes out of its operational design domain. And fallback ready User is a term that's reserved for level three driving automation, and that'll become clear in a moment. Operational design domain, I've already mentioned, that's essentially a catch-all term for the conditions under which a system is designed to operate. So it could be geofencing, it could be time of day, it could be lighting conditions, weather conditions, whatever. Object and event detection and response is a term that comes from the human factors world, but is very useful in this context as well. And essentially, it's what it's detecting things in the environment and responding to them. Receptivity is a term that we use for the fallback ready user, and this is just essentially a passive monitoring state. You're not monitoring a telephone or a fire alarm, but you're receptive to them when you hear them. Sustained operation, I think I already described, and another useful term is supervised. That's a term for what the driver does for a level one, level two system, where the system is not performing the complete DDT. the document also contains a list of deprecated terms. Again, we're not trying to be the language police per se. There's no way that autonomous is going to go out of the lexicon, and we don't expect that. We're just explaining why we don't use it in the engineering world and why it shouldn't be used where language matters and laws and regulations and standards. So autonomous in the robotic world really means self-sufficient, right? And what we're doing with automated driving is not self-sufficient. It will rely on at least GPS, but also probably on communications and other things. In the jurisprudence world, autonomous means law-giving or self-governing. And again, the systems are not self-governing. As one WAG put it, it's really not autonomous unless you can tell it to take you to work in the morning and it can decide to head for the beach instead. Again, we don't use self-driving or driverless or unmanned or robotic because these terms are just too imprecise, frankly, and they can confuse. And then I think it's also worth mentioning that we don't use automated vehicle either because it's really driving is the object of the automation, not the vehicle. And in the case of cars where they have an ADS, but they can also be driven by a human, it's confusing. This is the table out of the document. It is changed only in content, but it looks the same as pretty much the same as the first version. And these are the level definitions. So zero, of course, is no driving automation. The human performs the complete DDT and the DDT fallback. Level one, we call that driver assistance. That's sustained ODD specific execution of part of the driving, either the lateral or longitudinal vehicle motion control, but not both. And level two is both lateral and longitudinal control, vehicle motion control simultaneously, but the driver has to complete the OEDR subtask. Level three is conditional driving automation. This is the first level for an ADS where it's performing the complete DDT, but it relies on the human driver to perform the DDT fallback. Level four is an ADS that performs both the complete DDT and automatic DDT fallback in the event of a failure or exiting of the ODD. And level five is level four, but without an ODD restriction. So level five corresponds to level one. It's it could drive or operate the vehicle anywhere a human driver could on road. These are just some examples by level. Adaptive cruise control is a longitudinal vehicle motion control. And lane centering, of course, is lateral vehicle motion control. So having one or the other of those is a level one system. Level two would be having both where they operate simultaneously. Level three would be, for example, a traffic jam or highway pilot relies on the fallback ready user or the human driver to take over if whenever needed. You can also imagine a level three geofenced closed campus ADS dedicated vehicle with a remote fallback ready user, somebody in a command center who's able to take over if something goes wrong. Level four, you have sub-trip level applications. So for example, an ADS that operates only on high-speed roads, so a driver would have to drive the vehicle to the high-speed road, take over again when they get off. You can have trip level, level four systems, such as an automated valet parking system where you, curbside, use a control device to send it into a dedicated garage and then summon the vehicle back when you're ready. Of course, there's also level four ADS dedicated vehicle, geofence, closed campus type things. They're pretty prominent in the news, what Uber's working on and Google, et cetera. And at level five, you can have a dual use level five where you allow the human to drive when they want to and the ADS to drive when they don't want to. And or you can have a level five dedicated ADS dedicated vehicle. The thing to note is that the levels come in different flavors, so worth being aware of that. To date, only level one and two systems have actually been deployed. But you should also know that levels are not actually developmentally sequential. And the reason for that is that levels of automation and the ODD are actually orthogonal. So today we already have level four in the form of like airport people movers and vehicles that run on tracks. And you can also see that an open road level three application may actually be more technically challenging than a level four closed campus vehicle in terms of development. A few other issues that are probably worth mentioning are that levels are assigned rather than measured. The reason for that is that you really can't test every conceivable situation that a vehicle might find itself in. The Camp AVR projects put it that the level is essentially a promise to the user, right? We're going to tell you what the system does and what you need to do, if anything. And levels are mutually exclusive. It's not possible to have a feature that is both level one and two or that is both level three and four. So it's clear in that sense. But you can have a single automated driving system that delivers multiple features. So, and then finally, we've recognized that, of course, in level one and level two, the driver takes over any time. But even in level three, if the driver requests to take over from the ADS, you have to relinquish immediately. And that's because the driver is the fallback ready user, and they have that kind of final responsibility. But beginning level four and five, you may delay allowing a takeover by the driver, for example, if it's unsafe. For example, if the vehicle's operating very close coupled in a platoon, you wouldn't just hand control back to the driver because they'd crash, right? The vehicle would have to exit the platoon and then relinquish control. And this is where you can go and download what is actually a free document. SAE agreed to make this document available for free so that the states and other governmental organizations can refer to it without having a transparency problem. And if you want to learn more about SAE standards on connectivity and safe and green technology, there's another link as well. And finally, the chair of the parent committee is Steve Underwood from University of Michigan. I chair the definitions task force, and Nikki Emerides at SAE would be the contact person for all of these committees. And I apologize for my voice. I'm getting over bronchitis. So that's it. Thank you.